Hello and welcome to Auto Car Dialogues. Our topic today is the auto industry and market 2020 and beyond. And with us today, we have a very eminent panel to discuss the future of the auto market, the direction it's heading, the challenges and the opportunities. On my right, I have Mr. R.S. Kalsi, Executive Director, Marketing and Sales, Maruti Suzuki. Mr. Rakesh Srivastav, Senior Vice President and Marketing, Hyundai Motor Company.
Mr. Raja, Senior Vice President and Director, Toyota Motor, Kirloska.
And Mr. Janeshwar Sen, Senior Vice President and Marketing, Honda Cars India. Well, I'd like to kick this off by rewinding a bit and looking at the last year. We've had a bit of growth, 7 to 8%. But Mr. Kalsi, I'd like to kick off with you because you've seen some fantastic growth. How was the last financial year?
We grew at about, say, 11.5%. And industry, as you said, was 7% plus. And one of the areas of concern in the beginning of the year was a poor monsoon. Because of this, in rural sector, the growth was low. It was around, say, 10% plus compared to, say, 22-23% which we had last year. Nevertheless, by introduction of new models, introduction of new formats, we could manage a good growth.
And Mr. Srivastav, you've had a good year as well. But again, the sense I get is it's been a bit of a push market. You know, the days of double-digit growth are long gone. You really have to fight to sell every car. Do you think this is really now the way it's going to be?
To me, the last year was one of the best years in the last 5 years that we've seen. A volume of around 2.75 million, a growth rate of around 7.2%. I think that's been a good year. But yes, it came on challenges. One was the monsoon was indifferent. When we look at also in terms of the demand that was coming over earlier from passenger cars, it was very stagnant. The contribution of passenger car was just in the range of around 74%. It was the utility vehicles that actually drove the volumes. Yes, as Hyundai, we were able to do well. We did a volume of around 4,84,000 units, the highest by Hyundai in any single year in the last 17 years, the highest market share of 17.3%. But it came in on the strength of new models, the models like Creta or the Elite i20, and even for the industry, it was the new models that drove the volume. And the other thing that drove the volume was deep discounts.
Mr. Raja, I'd like to turn to you. From your point of view, I think it's been a pretty tough year. Obviously, the issue of the diesel ban in Delhi hasn't helped your big market, obviously. One of the tougher years for Toyota?
How much it was really a challenging year for us last year. But if I look at, I can tell you what our focus was. If I had looked at my Etios Liva segment, our efforts towards improving on efficiencies did give results in the market where it has been more of a new products gaining. We were having growth in that. We grew about 11-12%. Overall, it has been negative thanks to all these factors like monsoon or be it the Delhi ban, like 4 months was really affecting to the extent of 10-12% of our volumes in these markets. But one thing I would like to table it, I'm sure my colleagues will accept it, is if you look at the industry growth, which is 7-8%, take off the new models that have come in, the industry has degrown. So it's been a year where new products drove the volumes in the segment. That is where I think we have to catch up with more new products coming forward.
And Mr. Sen, a bit of a flat year for you, but you've had one launch. Do you also feel that it was a bit of a tough year for you? And despite even launch of the Jazz, you know, it's been a fight, like everyone says. It's really not, there's no pull in the market anymore.
Absolutely. It has been a tough year for us, even though we have shown some growth. We have done our highest ever, but if you look at the City, while it's still leading the segment, but you know, now it's over 2 years old in the market, so there is more competition as well. Jazz is at a stable level. Mobilio for us has been a bit of a struggle, to be very frank. Industry itself, I think, has been really tough for the industry. And what is even more worrying is that if we just see the last 3 months, typically the last quarter of the fiscal year is the high seasonality quarter. So this year, because of various environmental factors, we have seen no seasonality. And Q4 of last fiscal was particularly bad. Is that a signal for us? Is something that we have to now see, really.
So what's the way forward? Mr. Kalsi, I'd like to turn to you. You've done some new initiatives with the Nexa showroom to try to get new customers, to reinvent brands. What is the way forward to really find new customers and keep this level of growth?
One is that customer expectations are changing by the day, and what used to be, say, big delight factors a couple of years ago, they have become now hygiene factors. So it's not just new products that we have introduced, it's the features as well, new technologies as well, which we have to provide to the customer.
And that will come at a cost to you, which obviously does have some impact.
Well, it does come at a cost, and if I can quote you the examples of, say, two-pedal technology that we introduced and hybrid technology that we introduced, certainly these features are finding a good acceptance and creating a delight among the customers. But moving forward, soon they'll become qualifiers. Then also in terms of the retail experience, now we are using today four different formats of retailing. There's a format we use for rural marketing, then we have our, say, emerging market outlets, e-outlets, then we have conventional showrooms, which we have been having for almost now 30 years. And fourth format that we introduced based on the, say, changing expectations of the customer, to provide him a totally different experience, digital showroom. So through Nexa we have been able to provide that. So that's about the retail experience. Now, third thing which is emerging now, and maybe some ethnographic live-in studies will have to be done to understand customer psyche for the future, as you are saying, 2020. What is important here is that customers are using lot many gadgets at home.
So connectivity, say, like it's happening internationally, do you think that's going to be really one of the core driving factors and, let's say, a requirement going forward?
Yes, hybrid cars, connected cars, and certainly when a customer is using a handset or he is using a laptop at home, and every 6 months the technology is changing and a high level of personalization is happening there. So in future, I think we'll have to go in for that, and product life cycles will reduce, and maybe the average age of the customer is also going to reduce. So keeping those things in mind, auto industry has to prepare for 2020 and beyond.
I want to jump to you because Mr. Kalsi raised an interesting point on product life cycles being reduced. But I think in Toyota's case, let's take your Innova. It's come after 10 years, so really, and it still had quite a demand. So in Toyota's view, do you also see a shortening of life cycles going forward, or do you think typically Toyota would like to stretch the investment as far as possible?
See, ideally we would like to stretch as far as possible, but as Kalsi-san talked about cycles getting shorter, we are seeing that happening globally and in India. But where we see a big challenge on that is the infrastructure that is required for it. Say, for example, a fuel cell, a hydrogen station, or even talking about a plug-in hybrids. These are challenges which we need to grow, get those type of infrastructure, then only you can see technology coming. One, the technology coming in is going to come at a high cost. We look forward for government moving and supporting towards that, by which the industry brings in new products.
And Mr. Shivas, I want to turn to you because Hyundai, you've tried to attempt to have best-in-class features. Do you think the customer has become spoilt? I mean, great for the customer, but now more and more demanding. I mean, about 20 years ago, having power steering was just unheard of on a compact car. Now, right now, you have it on every variant.
I believe if customers are wanting more, it's good for the industry. A demanding customer is far better than having a customer who's not demanding. Because if the customer is not demanding, then you are looking at a different days. But what we should not forget exactly is, it is not only the youth. Customers of today are not only the customers of tomorrow, that is the youth, also customers of yesterday. People who have experienced brands of ours, product of ours, and they are the ones who are naturally looking for upgrades. I think we have to look towards the upgrade. And why? When will a customer upgrade? That's the point where it comes over in terms of packing the cars or packing the products with more features. Because if you're going to look towards saying that I'm going to look at the customers of tomorrow, well, affordability could be a challenge. They are coming in, they could have challenges in terms of affordability. But customers of yesterday are seeking more, wanting more, and I think that's the way forward, because the entry customer is maybe always the entry segment or the first time buyers is just around 30 to 35%. The rest of them are the ones who are either picking up a second car or are replacing a car. They are seeking features. That's a larger chunk, the bigger chunk.
I'd like to turn to actually both of y'all, because I think y'all have had the luxury of some very strong brands over the years. City been around for 20 years. Do you think that sometimes, you know, you all are trading a lot on the brand value, and it gives you a little bit of comfort or margin on not having to resort to sometimes desperate measures in terms of pricing or overloading the car with features, which, you know, in a way may not be great value.
For very well-established brands, things are a little easier. That's a fact. But in an intensely competitive market, you cannot depend solely on the brand. So brand is like a plant. You have to keep watering it to nurture it.
So do you think moving forward, as we go towards the next decade, it'll be tougher for you? Competition will also kind of maybe chip away at, let's say, the brand position, and you would have to work harder to kind of maintain the aura around the brand?
Automotive sector, or especially cars and even bikes and two-wheelers, is one sector where brand plays a very critical role. So we have to keep working on it. We have to stay ahead so that we keep exceeding the consumer's expectation. I think that's the key.
I'd like to talk about new opportunities in the auto market. Any new white spaces? Do you see any new segments emerging? Or do you think it'll just be an evolution of existing segments with maybe new technologies kind of, spurring more demand?
Well, a couple of things here. One is that, you know, we have to continuously explore the blue ocean markets. Second thing, as marketeers, we have to find out who are the non-users and convert them into users to expand the, markets. So here I would like to say that, as the technology is, changing, one extreme example I would like to give is the, two-pedal technology. Now, it will become very popular among the people who have a fear of driving, particularly, the youngsters or even the, elderly people who would not like to change, gears in the congested traffic. We are talking about GPS technology. We have, already mobile phones. We are thinking of, panic buttons in the cars. With that kind of a, safety assurance coming through technology and ease of driving through two-pedal technology, certainly there would be many non-users who will come into the user category. Second thing, a lot of youngsters who earlier used to think that car would be their, second priority, first they have to think of a house. Now they are thinking of having a car. The moment they come out of the college and they think that, yes, they can, afford the EMIs. So maybe, targeting those segments through a format like, providing driving training. We have today more than 360 driving training schools. So these are the segments which otherwise would have postponed their decisions to, buy a car.
So it's basically creating more efficiencies, a few more opportunities in the marketplace rather than any game-changing products itself. But turning to you, Mr. Srivastav, Hyundai, do you feel that there are any new segments you all are exploring? You all are not present in a lot. You all are not there really in the MPV segment. You're not in the compact SUV segment. I'm sure you all will look at that. But do you think there's any other niches which perhaps haven't been explored?
The point that you were making in terms of white spaces, I think let's look at it first in terms of the industry. I think all of us are serving one basic need, that is mobility. Where does the segmentation come in when we start looking at wants? And for us, we have to identify them. And how do these white spaces develop? These white spaces actually develop by way of sub-segments becoming later a bigger segment. Like the utility vehicle, the SUVs or the MPVs have become around. Now, that is the challenge for a marketing person to identify which sub-segment will become a segment in itself and then putting up a product. But the biggest differentiator is largely technology, because technology serves the need or the wants of the customers. So for us, a white space may be a white space today, but is it a space in which to launch a product today? That is a big question. That is what we need to address as marketing people.
Turning to you, Mr. Raja, from Toyota's point of view, the sense I get is a little bit more of a cautious approach, not really exploring these white spaces. But you have followed trends now, Innova coming also with an automatic, which wasn't there earlier. Do you feel there is also an approach to, let's say, instead of stretching yourselves, just honing the existing model range you have?
See, the approach has been guarding the turf. But since Rakesh has talked a lot about the new segments coming in, I would like to give you an attention of the current segments that are there. If you look at what is happening to the youth and the way it is moving, one trend we are seeing is personalization. Earlier, a customer moved into an A segment, B segment, C segment. Now we are seeing affordability, making a customer to buy even the B high-end cars, like high price, like start off with a 6-7 lakhs instead of a 3 lakh, 4 lakh type. Moving on to the point what you talked about on holding on to the turf, we do identify pockets which are where the customer is leaked out. Like if my Etios Liva customer today, if I have to move him into the next, maybe a Corolla, it is too high a jump. So we need to plug in the gaps, and that's what we are talking. And success what has been there is getting a platform which can give you a hatch, a sedan, a small SUV, a small MPV. That is the approach which we've seen we are successful, and that could be the way forward we would be moving as a learning also.
Honda as well, I mean, you've had one platform, the Brio platform, and had multiple body styles on it, multiple products on it. Obviously, it's given you a much larger volume, but at the same time, you vacated some segments. Are you also consolidating in terms of segmentation? Because it doesn't seem to be that exploring newer segments, especially where, you know, you were existing, you were already there in certain places, like the Civic.
If we leave Civic aside for a moment, CRV has been around for over 10 years, and we are reintroducing the new Accord later this year. So we have no real intentions of giving up segments. It's just a matter of right timing. But talking about segments, I think the way the market is evolving, what we really have to think about, instead of the normal segments that we are very much used to in the industry, what do the consumers really want? So things like connectivity and safety, I think these are the new things that we really have to look at, because we are spending much more time on the roads now. So instead of traditional body shape, depending on your affordability, possibly these are the things which people would look for much more in the car.
Winding down, one burning issue which is on everyone's mind is the jump from BS4 to BS6 2020. This is expected. Obviously, it's not going to be easy, but apparently it seems it's a reality. So just wanted to understand the concerns.
Well, one is the BS6 criteria, then other is the CAFE norms as well, where government is likely to introduce it by that time. And third is what government is today talking about, say pollution through diesel vehicles, even though they are conforming to the current regulatory requirements. These would be the challenges of future, certainly. As far as preparedness on technological front is concerned, I think we are prepared, and so is the case maybe with other OEMs. That is what I get to learn through various forums like SIAM and all. But one thing is the time frame which government has given, and they have preponed the implementation, which puts a lot of pressure, particularly when you are dealing with the multiple models. Second thing, the cost impact on petrol vehicles. There is a certain cost impact X, but cost impact on diesel vehicles would be multiple times of that, maybe 5 times, 6 times of what we'll have on the petrol technology. So entire equation between petrol and diesel models in terms of their price to value equation may change. It may totally reverse. So this kind of policies or policy change by the government in such an abrupt manner creates a lot of financial pressure, and also a pressure in terms of the direction in which the investments should be done. That is important. And another offshoot of this would be maybe more focus on hybrid technology, full hybrid technologies, and electric vehicle technologies. So I think auto OEMs have to think in that direction as well. And a lot of work is being done. And I certainly agree with you, the major challenge would be the cost impact.
That's what I wanted to ask you as well, Mr. Srivastav. The cost impact, what is it going to be like?
The auto industry has been very conscious about the environment requirements. And whenever a demand has been made on the auto industry, in terms of upgrading the technology is concerned, auto industry has always invested. What the auto industry would require is that advance time, so that every stakeholder is involved into it and can bring in the right kind of inputs in terms of the technology.
And for Toyota, BS6, clearly you all have the technology too. Is it too short a time? And one also hears that
are these sort of policy changes maybe putting some brakes on future investments? Because we have read that Toyota is quite cautious, and unless there's stable policy, future investment may slow down.
We are supportive of the government on initiatives. Let me look at how Indian industry is getting to global levels. Say 2017, the crash test norm comes in. 2019, something like the pedestrian safety comes in. The CAFE norms comes in 2018. The Euro 6 comes in 2020. So there's a lot of technology changes that is happening. And auto industry across has been very supportive of it. As such, I told you, we want to be part of solutions. We don't want to be the part of problems. Coming back to the point, what you said is, we want some stability. So what is happening is, for Make in India, where we are pitching with, say, TMC, where we are trying to say India is stable, you have to come in and start looking at more, getting more models made here.
But Toyota being Toyota, would it kind of, let's say, make them put in further investments, not on hold, but go a little slow on it?
What they're seeing is, no other industry is pushed to this level where auto industry is getting pushed, when we are all supportive of it. India is a big market, nobody can afford. Like 2025, I think India is going to be the third largest market after US and China. So nobody can afford to forget it. They're all ready to come in, but show some stability. That's the only request.
And as far as Honda goes, first to launch a hybrid car, not there now, but do you think BS6 might kind of accelerate introduction of more hybrids into this market? You're getting the Accord now.
Yes, we are coming back with a hybrid after 8 years or so. Only thing that is required, whether it's emission norms or safety norms or taxation or whatever else, there should be some kind of a roadmap, a proper roadmap, so that we can plan with confidence.
Okay, just last question, and very quickly from each one of you, moving forward, future policy changes, what would you like to see that you think can really spur the industry?
Certain things are important. One is a duty-friendly approach by the government, then consistency in the policies, and third is the focus, a big focus on infrastructure.
What's your, let's say, one take?
My one take would be as simple as that. I think auto industry should be seen as a need satisfier, rather than treating the auto industry as a luxury item provider, rather than that. Because the minute you take auto industry as a need satisfier, everything will start falling into place. Yes, GST could be one thing. If GST is brought in, it could actually not only bring in a positive towards the GDP of the country, it could also make things easier for the auto industry. The other aspect would be is infrastructure. The third part would be is the GDP growth itself. Because if the GDP grows, prosperity comes in, right? Per capita income increases, affordability comes in, aspirational levels can be met. So I would say is basically three things to look at it. One, GST. Second, infrastructure. And third, growth in the economy. If these three are there, I think we will be able to serve the basic need, and that is mobility.
I think Mr. Srivastava has covered it all, but I mean, is there anything you'd like to add?
After what he has said, but still let me touch upon particularly two things. One was government needs to support new technology, hybrids, for example. I know India, government needs to protect the local industry. With Make in India, new technology has to come in. Like if I look at the excise or the customs duty on imports, we are the second highest as far as import duties are concerned. Relax it for future technology. I'm not saying give it a free ride. Give a period of time. 5 years you are allowed this, after that you have to make it local. Something like that is the wish list for bringing in new technology, because everybody will find it difficult to bring in new technology and locally manufacture immediately from day one. Second, I would always look at the government to take charge of things and not get judiciary into it. And please, we have seen probably after alcohol and tobacco, auto industry is the second which gets sickest. Don't treat us like villains. We are here to give so much of employment and GDP more, so treat us better, that's all.
Would you echo those sentiments? Do you think the car really is still very much a luxury and it's just being taxed and taxed consistently?
Yes, it is one of the most highly taxed after all the central state taxes, and on top of that, the road taxes. So when you add that up, it's a huge amount.
On that note, I'd like to thank all of you all for joining us in what was a very interesting discussion. Clearly, the Indian auto market has a lot of potential. It is
going to be the third largest market by 2025. That's what a lot of forecasts say. But the road to growth is not going to be easy. Lots of challenges, but opportunities as well. Thanks for watching.